This is the motto of the show, Hour of the Truth. Rome never changes. They used to call us heretics and sent the Inquisition to kill us. Today they call us terrorists and send on their crusades. Times and methods may have changed, but goal still stays the same. Extirpate the remnant of the true Word of God, Bible-believing people who uphold the truths in Jesus Christ's name.
Suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believed in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man, salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Hello and welcome everybody to a new broadcast from Juggler 66, Hour of the Truth. This is part two of the part we have spoken before with Robert Newman. And without any further introduction, I will leave it up to Robert to explain what it's all about. And you can listen to the broadcast that we recorded a few days ago via Skype. I hope you enjoy and will learn a lot of these. So without any more ado, here's Robert.
Okay, in this second part, we're going to look at what is called a testamentary will. A testamentary will, and how, by an accident of history, inverted commas, how England became, and Germany, became so important in this development of the law. And I think it's a fascinating story, and it's little known to people.
Testamentary. It actually is little known to me, so I'm very interested in listening to this.
Okay. Testamentary. I mean, this is, if you leave property, or if you leave something to the next generation, to, let us say, to you, to the oldest son. Mm-hmm. This is a very, very ancient thing, isn't it?
Yeah, that's
very,
from
very
the Bible.
Straight from the Bible. This is the law of succession. So somebody will succeed somebody else, and somebody else will succeed somebody else, and somebody else will succeed. He succeeds as the heir to the estate. This is very ancient. This goes back to biblical times. Yeah. So this testamentary, testes, literally means the seed of your, of the fruits of the family, the eldest son, and so on. This law of succession, which relates to wills and to property and to inheritance, And God has his law. His law, whether we pay attention to it or not, his law is his law. Therefore, even when we were born with Christians are born to be an heir. We're not supposed to be slaves. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, because yeah, Christ right. has made us free, right?
Right, yeah. We're not supposed to be slaves, right? So therefore, we are an heir of that freedom which Christ has already purchased. Mm-hmm. Right, so, in this sense, if when we came into this world, we did not choose to come into this civilization.
That's but right. We did. And that's a big problem, Robert.
Yes.
You probably address that, but we are all born in trespasses and sins. Huh?
Yes,
the Bible
yes,
says
yes.
so.
The Bible says
but,
so, yes.
But we have no idea that we are born into a slave system.
Well,
nobody ever told us that. Nobody ever told us that we can even make a will to get to know to the authorities that, hey, here I am living, and I don't want to participate in that system that you set up against my knowledge, and you put me in against my knowledge. But now I know, and now I want to be set free. I think this is a little bit where we have to go with this broadcast.
Yes.
To tell people about that we have been born in trespasses and sins, as the Bible says, but we also have been born to be ignorant to a system that we do not know and that nobody ever explained to us. Even our parents didn't, because they were as ignorant as we are.
Yes, that's absolutely correct. But God is not ignorant.
No, he's not. No.
Therefore, because God is not ignorant, even though we may, what do they say? My people perish for lack of knowledge.
Yeah, in Hosea 4.
Hosea 4, right. Okay, right. So whether we know or don't know, some people will say, I don't like the system because it's against me. But actually, so many times we are against ourselves. It's not so much the system that's against us. It's we who have overstayed our visit to the kindergarten, if you look at it like that.
Yeah, that's an interesting point of view. Yeah.
Right? if we look
We're
at
all
it,
little toddlers, right?
if we look at it like that when my mother, my father, your father, walked into the registry and everyone said, oh, we are selling ourselves into slavery because I've been registered with the state and so on. If you take the conspiracist point of view, if you look at it from a conspiracy point of view, you will find lots of evidence to support the idea that it's a conspiracy. If, however, you do not use the conspiracy point of view, I know it's difficult. It's very difficult to imagine that it's not a conspiracy. But I'm not going to use the conspiracy point of view. I'm going to use the law point of view. And I think it's quite wonderful to look at it like this. That when my mother and my father went into the registry and they registered the birth of the newly born baby, who was born into the hospital, probably. Do you know the word hospital means hospitality? Yeah, that's the derivation of the hospital, and hospitality is the same thing.
Yeah, okay. So, in Germany, we don't call it hospitals. We call it Krankenhäuser, sick house.
Oh, sick house, okay. Yeah. Okay, that's consistent with
So maybe Germans have to get another understanding.
No. The German understanding is completely accurate, because we are born in sin and trespasses, so that means we are sick, right? So if both of these things are correct, but the point I'm making is that when we were born, We received some assistance when we were born. We were probably born in a hospital which was paid for by the state, and many things. We received maybe medical care. We went to school. We had certain benefits. And so it's indisputable that we received some benefits even when we were small children. No question about that, right?
That's indisputable.
Indisputable, right? It's also indisputable that the system that we have knows more about what we have done and what we have not done and what we paid and what we didn't pay. We were very bad accountants. We were very bad at managing our stuff. We were actually incompetent, if we are really honest about it. And these people, they know every address that we've lived in. They know what we paid, what we didn't pay, what we're supposed to pay. And they keep very good records. If you hired an accountant like that, you would be very happy with his performance, no? Mm-hmm. He knows, but we consider that this is very bad. They know everything about us and all the rest of it. But if you look at this, in a situation like a trust, mm-hmm. how would you say, what's the German word for trust? Trust relationship. It means somebody is a trustee. Do you know these words, trust or trustee?
Yeah, yeah. In German, we use the word Treuhand.
Treuhand, right? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. That's even in Germany after the so-called unification of Germany in 1990, this big fake that they played before our eyes. They set up a Treuhand ministry, so a trust ministry.
Trust ministry.
Yeah. To see what assets, what estates came out of the Eastern Germany and is now to be brought into Western Germany, into the whole of Germany, you know?
Right.
To distribute the wealth and the companies and all that stuff.
Right.
Therefore, they had that trust company called Treuhandgesellschaft in Germany. Yeah,
Treuhand, right. Okay, the Treuhand, all of the public people working in the public side of the government, for example, the social security, defense, the local authorities, and these people are in public service. These people are public servants, no?
Yeah.
The police people, all of these people, they're all in public service, all of these people. And there are benefits for people who don't work and who are sick and all of this sort of. So I'm taking a non-conspiratorial view of the situation. And so when we were registered with the state as babies, we were completely incompetent. We obviously didn't know about these things, and we obtained some benefits. But when we became older, and we go to school, and the first thing that we learn is how to register, because every morning they starting with registration. Registration becomes such an important thing.
Yeah.
Registration, everything has to be registered. And do you know the word register means? It means to give the title of something. Mm-hmm. That's what registration means. You will give the control of something. When you register, you give control over when you register. Regis means king.
Yeah, so that actually means that when the teacher calls my name, are you there? You are registered, then you give over your authority to the teacher.
That's correct. Yeah.
Just trying to explain this sometimes, hard to understand in plain words, you know.
Yes, you're giving the jurisdiction of yourself to... Yeah. You give the jurisdiction to the teacher, and the teacher is older than you are. She has responsibility to take care of you. Mm-hmm. That's the registration process. If you go to a court, they will say, are you John Smith? And they don't want to speak to Helen Brown. They want to speak to John Smith. And John Smith said, yes, I'm John Smith. So they're registering this. The registration is very important for the system. And
doesn't there also come the term to understand?
Understand, yes. Understand.
When the judge asks you, do you understand this? He actually means that you stand under me and under my authority. Isn't that a little bit how that is to be understood also?
In that context, yes.
Yeah, in that context.
In that context, but actually if you have an understanding, that means you have something under your feet, which is very strong. Yeah, it's not you who has the understanding, it's you standing on the understanding. Yeah. If you're standing on something that is solid, that is an understanding.
Yeah. That's so, why we should all stand on the rock, right?
You have to stand on this. So I want to just talk about the testamentary will. Now, the testamentary will did not exist in the time of St. Paul. The Roman, you know, in ancient Rome, there was no thing called a testamentary will. They had wills. They had wills. The Romans, the ancient Romans, they had wills, but they didn't have a testamentary will.
So what's the difference?
The testamentary will is when one generation gives through to the next generation. And the one who was responsible for the testamentary will was only one individual. And this individual is called an executor. He is the executor of the will. Yeah? Executor.
Yeah, okay.
Right, okay. This executor is the chief executive of the estate. He's the only one that's dealing with this subject. There are not many of them. There's one of them. Yeah, this executor I'm talking about.
Yeah, okay.
The executor is extremely powerful. He is the boss, but he's not the boss because he's not the boss because he's intelligent. He's the boss because he has been given all the authority by the testator of the will. The testator is the man who is writing the will. Yeah? The testator is writing a will, and he gives the power to the office of executor. He names the executor in the will. Yeah?
Yeah.
He names the executor in the will. So you see that the man is appointing an office. And this office is not the man, it's an office. He's creating an office called the office of executor. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I try to follow, yeah.
Yeah, it's like if you created, if you were sending an agent to Japan, and you were the son of a king or something, you would send the ambassador to Japan.
Yeah.
And the ambassador, this would be your ambassador. This ambassador is going to Japan. When he gets to Japan, your ambassador...
is the executor of my will.
Yes, he's going with certain instructions, and he will present himself to the Japanese people, and he will say, yes, I have been sent by George. George Gleesman has said, oh yes, here is my authority, here is my paperwork, here are my credentials.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Right. So he will say, okay, are you representing yourself? Say, no, I'm not representing myself. I'm representing George. And oh, so you are the ambassador of George? Yes. Okay, please show me your documents. And then they will look at the documents. If an ambassador goes to a different country, they have to show the pieces of paper before they can be accepted as the ambassador, right? It's the same thing with the will. If you have a will, a testamentary will, you have to have an executor for it. This is an office. It's the office of executor.
Is that like the notary?
It's similar to a notary, but it's restricted to the business of the man. You know, he's not trying to change policy outside of the estate. He's only interested in what he's been given to do by the man. That's his office, is to take care of the things of the estate. That's his job. And it's a very powerful office. Yeah? Does that make any sense?
Yeah, so where are you going with this?
Okay, right. So the testamentary executor did not exist in the Roman world. In the Roman world, there were many wills. The Roman lawyers would make many wills, but they didn't have a testamentary executor. They didn't have the idea of succeeding one family after another into many generations and so on. They didn't have those things. But in the 4th century, around the same time as the papacy is developing, you know, it's developing in the 1st and 2nd century, it's getting stronger. And then in the 4th century, you have Diocletian, and then you have the Council of Nicaea. And by the 4th century, I think it's 381, then you have the Romans saying that the Church of Rome is the only kind of Christianity. You know, that Theodosius.
Yeah, that started already with Constantine.
Yeah, Constantine. Then Theodosius. Theodosius, 381. Theodosius decides the only legitimate form of Christianity is the Church of Rome. Mm-hmm. That's in 381. Then you have Pontifex Maximus, which is the same time, and the papacy becomes the Pontifex Maximus, and all of this stuff is happening by the 4th century. And then around the year 800, they invented the idea that the Pope, the papacy owns the whole of Europe. Did you know, you heard that one? You know that?
Used with that the falsified donations of Constantine.
The donations of Constantine.
Right? And the Isidorian decretals.
Hey, that's it, exactly, yeah, okay. So they started to claim that they actually owned all of the land. But the testamentary executor did not exist. So then around the period, the 5th century, immediately after the papacy is formed to claim that they are the only Christian church, immediately afterwards, from Germany, comes the earliest documentary evidence of testamentary wills. It was Germany who did that. German Christian people, in fact. I give you a few examples. Edictum Theodorici, which is a document. This is an actual will. And appointing, this is a German document.
Yeah.
And Lex Withigorothum. Lex Withigorothum. Lex Burgundonium. These are 5th century documents. They are the oldest documents we have to a testamentary will. And they're all German.
Okay.
And then I want to quote from a book by a man called Goffin. Talking about Germany and the importance of this development is coming from Christian Germany in the 5th century. This is Goffin. He said, it's not necessary to explain the motives by which these different tribes adopted this kind of a will. The testament borrowed from the Romans, the Germanic people developed out of their own selves. They ultimately established the institution of the testamentary executor. It's on page 16 of this book. And this book's talking about, the name of this book is called Testamentary Executor in England and Elsewhere. It was the German people, the German Christians of the 4th century and the 5th century. But there were testamentary wills before this, but none of them have survived. The earliest one is 466 to 484, and that's a German.
So that's about the time of the fall of the Roman Empire, right?
Exactly.
When the German tribes invaded Rome.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And so the testamentary executor was already known in Germany in the 5th century, long before it came to England. Mm-hmm. Long before it came to England. But the accident of history was this, that when the Pope gave all of the land to the barons in England, he didn't realize at that time what he was doing. Because when he gave all the land to the barons, he also gave them the executive control of the land. Mm-hmm. And they inherited it, and they inherited it, and they inherited it generation by generation, until they made a fatal mistake. And the fatal mistake was this, that the barons and their ancestors were then ordered that they have to go and fight in the Crusades in Palestine. So many of the barons, they got their horses and they were obedient to the Pope, and they went to the Middle East and they started fighting in the Crusades, etc. Meanwhile, back in England, the wives and the families left back in England, there were no banks in those days. What happened when the family started to get into trouble, or the tenants couldn't pay the rent? Gradually, with the First Crusade, Second Crusade, Third Crusade, there started to be big problems back in England, because these people were in Palestine fighting the, and for centuries, the Crusades, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
The administration.
The Holy City again, yeah.
Yeah, the administration of these estates, and I call them estates because they were estates, the administration started to have more and more and more problems. Wives would go to the king in London and say, I haven't heard from my husband for several years. The rent is not being paid. There are children who have no money. What do I do? I am the landlord. My husband is not here. Can you help me? And this was happening all the way across England at that time. So eventually the king gave the job to a special department. And this is the Chancellor. The Chancellor was responsible for the money system in the English government. The Chancellor decided, okay, if you have a testamentary will, I can help you. They didn't even know what a testamentary will was.
So they didn't have one.
Oh, they did have one, but they had no connection with their husband. He didn't know also, because the lawyers had done these things. They didn't understand the law. It was total confusion, right? It was a total confusion situation. The government decided, okay, here's the rule. When your husband comes back, send him to the Chancellor, and the Chancellor will sort it out. And because this happened, then slowly the story got out that there is a testamentary will. Some people learned about it, but the lawyers didn't want to talk about it because it was kind of, you know, privileged information. Mm-hmm. And that is
how... Need to know basis.
On the need to know basis, right? So then, and it was because of this German development that that Glanville, the man we talked about before, in the time of Henry II. This is where Glanville rediscovers what the German people had done.
Yeah, you still owe us the answer to the question about Glanville, right?
Which question?
When he was explaining to King Henry II about the taxation system, you still owe us the explanation to that from the first part. You didn't finish that.
Which part do you ask me, please, if you want to?
Don't you remember? We were speaking about that in the first part, and then we were derivating to other things, like the things now.
You want to hear more about that? Well, what?
I know he was ordered by the king to look out in the Bible and in all the texts, in all the law books or whatever, what was there about taxation, and then you derive to Matthew 27, Matthew 17, sorry,
Yeah.
And we read about that, but you never finished the things that he actually revealed or had to reveal to the king.
That is what that is what he revealed. That is what he found. He found Matthew 20,
Matthew 17, yeah.
Matthew 17. And then he understood. He made contact with other people. They said, do you mean that the children are free when, in this private side of the equation? And that was what he discovered. I did answer what you said. The German people understood this, or some German people understood this. In the first century, second century, third century, fourth century, fifth, but eventually England understood this in the 11th century because of Glanville. Mm-hmm. So I think I have, I've given you, but until you read his book, but he's publishing a book not only about the tax system, he's publishing a book about the laws of England. And in the modern time, when the sea covers the land, there is a pressure coming on the law system to, how would you say, to be assertive. The law will assert itself through the civil system. Because the civil system spreads across the land. But eventually the law will assert itself above the civil system. It's still available, but nobody's contacting it. That's what's happening in England right now. The law is still the law, but nobody is using it. And that's what we're living in today. Glanville died in 1190, but he was the Chief Justice of England. So he lived at the time when Henry II was humiliated for failing to collect the taxes efficiently for the Roman system. So they created another crown at that time, a crown corporation. The crown corporation started in the city of London. Mm-hmm. And the city of London made a franchise, like Kentucky Fried Chicken, what do they call it? What's the other one?
McDonald's or whatever.
McDonald's, yeah. Is this franchise? They sold this franchise outside of London, so there was an agent for the franchise in all of the counties of England. And this was very efficient for collecting the tax. Mm-hmm. So Rome solved their problem, and then England went back to sleep again. Because, you know, still very few people understood these things. And the other thing was other people started studying the biblical law, for example, the commandments, and this is how the development of the English law. They always went to the Old Testament. For example, that it's illegal to steal a person. Mm-hmm. The prohibition of stealing originally, if you go to Exodus 21:16, the eighth commandment. That's Exodus.
And 20. He that stealeth a man and selleth him, or if he be found in his hand, he shall surely be put to death.
Yes, it was a capital punishment under the law to enslave another human being.
And what's the Pope doing with all of us today?
Well, exactly. That's exactly my point. So it was a capital punishment under the... Did you know that there was never a slave market in ancient Israel?
I'm not quite sure about that, yeah.
Every other country in the Middle East had a slave system, but there was never a slave market in ancient Israel. Ever, at any time. It's remarkable, really. Yeah.
No, they had servants and all, and when you were in debt with somebody else, you had time to work your debt off. And
that's correct.
Then
yeah.
they had jubilee years, and in the jubilee year, all your debt was forgiven, and you start anew.
Yeah. Yes.
But that was not that way in the pagan systems, of course. And we are living today in a pagan system. We have to remind our listener to that once.
Yes, that's perfectly correct. Because the people who controlled the people who controlled the papacy were Christians who were not Christians, and they were Jews who were not Jews. These people were controlling the Vatican. Even in the beginning, it became a political organization, no? Is it not?
Well, the papacy is a political organization from the beginning because it combines the seat of the Caesar with the seat of the Bishop of Rome.
Exactly. Well, yeah, exactly. And it was, what's his name? It was, Diocletian, the Roman Emperor Diocletian?
Yeah.
Diocletian. Who was persecutor of the Christians. You remember this man? Diocletian created the modern office of bishops. It was in the year 300. 300. He lived in Yugoslavia. Diocletian.
Mm-hmm.
Diocletian created a system of bishops in every part of the Roman civilization. Bishops.
Yeah.
Not the word bishop was changed. It started to mean the Roman governor of that.
Yeah, it's actually where we have our dioceses from today.
Yes.
And every country in Europe is divided into into different dioceses.
Those were,
for example, back instituted by Cardinal Wiseman in the 1850s in England.
Yeah. Notice the word diocese. Duo, it means two, twin, or diocese, a seizure. It means to grab something, no? If you seize something, if you have a seizure, something is seizing you.
Yeah, we have to go a little bit into etymology.
Yeah, of course. Okay, or how about the word bishop?
That's bishop,
Bishop, B-I, means two, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Shop, what is the shop? It's a place where you're buying and selling, no?
Yeah, trading, yeah.
If you're trading, if you want to get a fishing license, you have to get a license. If you want to go fishing, you have to buy a license.
If you want to drive a car, you have to get a license.
You have to get a license, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a shop to sell things. These people, the buy shops, the buy shop will sell you licenses. If you go to the registration, they will give you get a license. To do something, you can travel, but you need a license because you're a driver.
Mm-hmm.
Driving is a profession, so you need a license to drive. It's free if you want to travel, but if you want to be a driver, you have to pay a license. Strange things, huh?
Yeah, but that subject goes very, very deep.
Of course, I don't want to.
I've heard in the past Nicholas Arthur from First Amendment Radio speaking about these things because he has some kind of travel document that even releases him from having a driver's license over there in the United States of America.
And
he often does broadcasts about these, but this is not so clear when you don't understand it in the right context. And the right context is very hard to understand sometimes because even here I am sitting now and you are throwing words around me that I have to see to grasp here a little and there a little and try to make an understanding out of it. It's not that easy. And I guess.
No, it's not easy. But
I guess
but
some of my listeners also will have a little bit of the problem with
well,
that.
Well, okay. Every person. If you own a property, if you think that you own a property, you need to... If you think you own a property, it is owning you. You are the steward of the property, but you are not the owner of the property. That's the important thing. Yeah? People believe they own property, but you don't actually... What you have is 70 years and 10. As a steward of the property,
mm-hmm.
isn't that correct? The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. Right. So we don't. When we think that we own something, this is what's bringing the liability into our life. we register at the registry, and they give you a certificate, and you think that you own this property. Hmm. But actually, you are obliged to pay the liability for claiming to own the property. Hmm. What did Jesus say to the rich man? Give away everything you have and come and follow me.
Yeah.
So that's another question, another subject was Matthew.
Do you have a bad connection there? Because you're falling away from the sound.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, but you should watch your connection because we only have 2 yellow stripes of 5 white available. So.
Right. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you, but there's something wrong with your connection. I don't know if you can fix that.
Right. I'll try to. Shall I call you back?
No, it's okay. Just continue, but just be aware that there are little problems with the sound.
Okay. Matthew, what was the profession of Matthew, the disciple of Jesus?
Wasn't he a doctor?
He was a tax collector.
He was a tax collector. Okay. Who was a doctor then?
Luke.
Ah, Luke. Yeah, okay. That's
right.
He was a doctor from Syria, as I'm not mistaken.
I think so, yeah. The reason I ask you is that the word custom, if you look at the word custom in the New Testament, custom.
Yeah.
Matthew was sitting at the seat of custom in the English Bible.
Mm-hmm.
That means revenue. He was collecting taxes. Matthew was a tax collector. So that takes us back to the beginning of our conversation. That common law comes from the custom of the king's court.
Yeah.
So the
tax office of the king's lord.
The tax office of the king, yeah. The tax office of the king. The kindergarten side of the equation.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why the public side is full of liability. You receive bills, because that's the kindergarten side of the equation.
Okay, so what's the grown-up side of the equation?
Equity. That's the bridge I was talking about.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay.
And how can we all come to the law of equity?
How can you come to the law of equity? This is what we're talking about. We're talking about this will in which you give, the law of giving rather than the law of taking. I own this. It belongs to me. This is the Western way of, this is our crazy way of thinking.
That is absolutely true, yeah.
Yeah. So there is a law of giving, and there is a law of receiving, and there is a law of accepting, and so on. That if you give the right to use the property to your people during your lifetime through a will, then you don't claim to own it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Right. If you don't claim to own it, then you are not liable to pay it. That's what I'm saying. It's only when you claim to own something that you have to pay bills for it. Let me give an example. If you have an aquarium in your house, and I come to visit you, and you say, Robert, I'm going to give you this aquarium, and it's very nice fish in this aquarium, and I said, thank you very much, Jörg, I will collect it tomorrow. And then I go away. and then you knock on the, somebody knocks on the door, they said, Jörg, you have not paid your bills. I'm going to take all the property away from this house. I'm going to take it to the warehouse because you did not pay your bills. And Jörg said, okay, you can take any, you can take the property, but don't take that aquarium, because I already gave it to somebody else. And he will say, can you prove that you gave it to him? Yes, here is a letter. I gave it to my friend Robert.
Mm-hmm.
Here's proof that I gave it to him. He will not take away the aquarium. He will leave the aquarium. Why? Because you already gave it to somebody else. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's why people form companies like limited companies and all that stuff.
Well, okay, it's a simple thing to understand, no?
Yeah, because then it's not their personal asset, but it is of the companies, right?
Exactly. Well, that's exactly my point. It's this principle of giving. If you give something, then you do not have bills for it. Then the property will not be taken away. If you give to somebody else to use it and to enjoy it, this is the law of giving. This is the law of giving. And the people who, you know this parable of the Good Samaritan? Do you know, you heard of that?
Yeah.
The parable of the Good Samaritan. There was a law. Did you know that Jesus was talking to a lawyer at that time?
No, I wasn't aware of that.
But
it's about this guy who gets robbed and lies in the street.
Yeah, but let's find this parable, because it's talking about these things. Parable. See if you can find that, Jörg, because parable of the Good Samaritan. Can we find that? It's just very rich things. Maybe we can finish after that, because
Luke 10:25-37 it says.
Yes, 10:25-37. Right. Okay. This is very remarkable. It's before then. Luke 10:25. I read this?
Behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?
Yes.
And he said unto him, what is written in the law? What readest thou? And he answering, saying, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and all thy soul, and with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live. But he, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And Jesus answering and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him, and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him, and bound up his wounds, pouring oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence, and gave him to the host, and said unto him, take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these three, thinkest thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, he that showed mercy on him. And Jesus said unto him, go, and do thou likewise.
Yes, this beautiful parable. If you examine this more closely, it starts with verse 25, a certain lawyer. This is a certain lawyer. What does it mean, a certain lawyer? It means a notable lawyer.
Yeah.
This is an outstanding lawyer. This is a well-known lawyer. This is an outstanding lawyer. A man who had a real reputation.
Mm-hmm.
Stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit? He was tempting him. And Jesus immediately replied, "What is written in the law? How readest thou?" That's a brilliant. In other words, Jesus saying, "I will not interpret this for you because you're tempting me. Well, how do you see this?" And that's a brilliant answer, no? Mm-hmm. And he said, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself." He said unto him, "Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live." But he, having tempted him, willing to justify himself, justify means by the law, right? He still had a very hard heart, this man. Mm. Willing to justify, said Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" So it wasn't a friendly question. It was another hard question coming from the lawyer. And Jesus answered, said, "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded and departed, leaving him half dead." I want to look at this here. A certain man. This was a notable man. And just like the certain lawyer, a certain man. It wasn't just a man, it was a certain man.
Yeah.
A man of status. Went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Jerusalem spiritually is the highest place on the earth. Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm.
Jericho is the lowest physical place on the earth.
Yep.
This is remarkable, yeah? Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. He's presumed to be dead. This is the presumption of death. You see that?
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
That's what this is talking about. Jesus knew exactly what this lawyer knew. He knew much more than that lawyer did. Mm. Here is the presumption of death. And Jesus is painting this picture. Here's a man who is presumed to be dead. See how that ties in with what we're talking about?
Yeah.
This man is presumed to be dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked and passed. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him, and went to him, and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said to him, "Take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these 3 things thinkest thou was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves?" And he said, "He that showed mercy on him." Then said Jesus unto the lawyer, "Go in your career and do the same."
Yeah, when I was reading this with Tom, we are doing regularly Bible study, we were reading this.
Yeah,
he said this parable to be understood, and that's the way they understood it at that time.
Yeah,
when the man departed and took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto them, "Take care of him. Thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee." Has to do with the second coming of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
A pence for 1,000 years.
So
2,000 years have been paid, and whatever is more to be paid, he will pay when he comes back.
Yes, I mentioned that to Tom before, myself. And
that's probably why he explained it to me that way when we study. Yeah.
Okay, if you go to let's follow, keep that place there, and go to the book of Revelation, and let's go to the... wait a second. Now this ties in with this here. Right. So, Revelation chapter 6. If you go to Revelation chapter 6.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Revelation chapter 6, and it's verse 1.
And I saw when the lamp opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, come and see.
And sorry, I beg your pardon. It's not one. It's verse... and
He opens the seven seals here, right?
So yes.
Which seal is it?
Right. Okay. Okay. The third seal. Third. Revelation 6:5.
Mm-hmm. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see.
Yeah.
And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand.
Yes. And the next verse?
And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. And see, thou heard not the oil and the wine. This goes right back to what we've just read, yeah.
Exactly. Now, you see, in the 3:5, and when he opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of cymbals which represent the legal industry.
Yeah, the balances are always used with the goddess Justitia, right?
Yes. Yeah. Justitia, right. A black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances. Well, and I heard a voice in the middle of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny. That's one penny.
Yeah.
And three measures of barley for a penny. That is two pennies, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. And see, thou art not the oil and the wine.
Well, that was what the Good Samaritan...
That was put on him to heal his wounds.
The Good Samaritan gave two pence to the innkeeper, remember?
Yeah,
that?
Exactly, yeah.
So here is a time in the Bible where the black horse represents the black horse rider, this power that's on the horse, has control of people's lives. This rider.
Like the black priests.
Yes, and had a pair of balances, and then a voice in the middle of the four beasts said, a measure of wheat for a penny. See, you do not hurt the oil and the wine. You can do a lot of damage, but you are not allowed to touch the oil or the wine. That's what the voice is speaking to this situation, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
The oil and the wine. They're not allowed to touch that.
Now, the oil and the wine, that stands for the gospel, right?
Yes, you're not allowed to touch these. You're not allowed to hurt this situation. Amazing stuff, no? The parallels there. Lloyds Bank in London, City of London, has a black horse for a symbol also. Have you noticed that?
No, I'm not familiar with that, the Jesuits, of course, have their Pegasus, you know?
Yeah.
The flying white horse.
Flying white horse, right. Oh, right, okay. So all of these things run in parallel. And so, yes, the legal industry, the law, the enforcement system, and these are fascinating areas. So I often look at this because from a biblical point of view, it's marvelous, fascinating, wonderful, and so on. So, yes. But coming back to the will situation, yes, the will is absolutely essential. If you do not have a will, everybody has a will. If you go to a supermarket, you have a will.
Yeah.
If you write down, I want two tins of apricots and I want a loaf of bread or something, you're writing this. But people don't care about the will themselves. They don't care about this. They're always thinking that it's something I will do. It's nothing to do with living people. It's to do with death, and I'm not going to talk about that. But a living will, that is something. That is really something important.
Well, then maybe we have to talk about how you're going to set up that living will. Because
how would you set it up? What do you mean? You would get it?
I mean, something like we were talking in private sessions before, you know, when we were speaking about the Sister Kivi Act, when we were speaking about the person, when we were speaking about Well, rendering to Caesar what is Caesar's, you mean? Go to the town hall, give them your driver's license, your birth certificate and all that stuff and say, here, you have got the person that you created. Do with it what thou wilt, but I'm a free man born under Jesus and Jesus is my king and I'm free and I don't belong to your system.
Yeah, but it's not exactly that, because...
No, but we were speaking a little bit about those things, and we should maybe deepen that a little bit out. Maybe that would also be interesting for our listeners in the next session.
Oh, if we have a... If people are not angry with what we're talking about, that will
I don't care if they're angry.
No, but...
You know, a lot of people are angry when they hear the truth for the very first time, and... the things that you were saying make a lot of sense, and you are very well studied in this law, even though you're not a lawyer. But I think that a lot of people also get something out of this, because you know, when you go to the internet, when you go to YouTube, you're always confronted with people who upload these videos about the straw man and all that stuff, and they understand here a little and there a little, but they never get the whole picture. And I think that you have the ability to paint for the picture, paint for the people an even bigger picture of understanding of this whole situation.
Well, firstly, the most important thing is I never wanted to make, I do not want to encourage the conspiratorial interpretation of these things.
I understand.
I said, and second, one of the most important things was this, the relationship we have with the system is created for a beneficial reason.
Yes, it's created for a beneficial reason, but let me tell you that one thing. I don't know if I have read that to you before.
Okay.
I'm just going to look that up. That is one of the most important sentences I've ever read in the book Rulers of Evil that you are probably familiar with. And you know that I've read that on my YouTube channel because I told you that. So
right, okay.
just look that up. Just give me a second. Where is it? Oh, now Adobe Reader has stopped working. Wonderful. That never happened before.
That's okay. What was it? What's it talking about?
I'm gonna give you the quote just in a minute.
Okay.
So, get it. He never does that. Reader all of a sudden stops working. Never does that with me.
Oh, that's okay. Well, it's happening.
That's strange.
For a reason. So, but what's it talking about? That people want to control us and of course I understand. People want.
I've never had that before. What is that now? When I get these... Oh, incredible. I've never had that before.
Never had? What have you never had? You've
well, I'm doing a word search in Rulers of Evil.
All right.
And all of a sudden he says Adobe Reader has stopped working.
Okay.
Never experienced that before. So.
Right.
Okay. Anyway, let's go there because it must be in chapter 24, I think, or chapter 25.
You know this book very well.
I know it very well, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a quote from Michael Novak that I'm talking about. Michael Novak is... someone who also wrote in the, I think it was in the foreword of the Global Vatican.
Right.
Ah, okay, I got it. It's chapter 20, yeah.
Okay.
What the seal of the United States of America represents to anyone who takes it seriously is a ministry of sin. So we are speaking about the seal of the United States of America, okay? Mm-hmm. A speech by Jesuit political scientist Michael Novak, and he is in the first chapter of the Global Vatican, that book that Tom Press reads on Inquisition Update, or read last year on Inquisition Update. He published in the January 28, 1989 issue of America, that is the weekly magazine of American Jesuit, And he sums it up very eloquently. He says, quote, "The framers wanted to build a novus ordo that would secure liberty and justice for all. The underlying principle of this new order is the fact of human sin. To build a republic designed for sinners, then, is the indispensable task. There is no use building a social system for saints. There are too few of them, and those there are impossible to live with. Any effective social system must therefore be designed for the only moral majority there is, sinners." End quote.
Yes, yes. Well,
there's something to think about, right?
Well, when Novak is talking about this, he mentions the words liberty and justice.
Yeah, because this is in the Constitution of the United States of America, liberty and justice for all, you know?
Right,
liberty. It's their cry opposed to what we've had in the French Revolution.
Yes.
Fraternity, equality, liberty, blah, 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 you know?
You know, of course, that the Statue of Liberty...
That's freedom, that's the
it's not. No. That liberty in liberty in the United States of America means... the law of the sea. That's what it means. Liberty. If you have liberty from a ship, you heard in America they have a liberty ship. The Statue of Liberty is welcoming you to the harbor of New York.
Yeah.
It's the law of the sea.
Yeah, liberty. The Statue of Liberty actually presents Semiramis.
Yeah, liberty.
The kingdom of heaven.
Justice. Justice. No man. We know. From the Bible, you do not want the justice of God. Who wants the justice of God? Nobody wants the justice of God. You cannot stand in the justice of God. You want the grace of God. Who wants justice of God?
That's true.
Liberty and justice.
We all fall short on the glory of God.
Yeah, justice. Yeah, so liberty and justice is complete. This is the kindergarten. This is what I'm saying, is that the law is there. There's a little bit of latitude, but it gets weaker and weaker and weaker. Why does it get weaker and weaker? Because they constructed this bankruptcy, and this bankruptcy requires the administration of a bankruptcy. That's why they have courts that are administrative courts. That's why mortgages exist. That's why nobody can pay the mortgage. That's why the occupier of the property. How do you say in Germany, in German, occupier, if somebody's occupying the property?
Besetzer.
Besetzer, right. An occupier of the property. Imagine a country is completely under the occupation.
Yeah, like if, Germany is since the Second World War.
Yeah,
completely under occupation.
Under occupation. Right, so occupation, what does occupation mean? It means that the people have voted for their own... they don't want a will. They have voted for the state. The state is the sovereign. The state is controlling everything. And people want this to happen.
Well, that's true, but I don't think that Germans after World War II chose that.
No, no,
I think the Germans didn't even have a choice.
That's correct. Yes,
they were put into occupants without even their knowledge.
That's absolutely true. I'm not saying that the Germans chose these things to happen. I'm saying that a generation later, people have got used to the idea that the state is sovereign. But the state is not sovereign. The state never will be sovereign. The state is only an impersonation of the estate.
Yeah.
The state is crude. People believe in the state. They cannot live without the state. And that's where the law of occupation comes from. If you take a book on the law of occupation, I have a book here. Can I read one sentence from this book?
Sure.
Remember what I was saying in many law books? The first sentence of the book is often tremendously full of information.
Yeah, you said that.
Right. Okay. This is Oxford University, and this book is called The International Law of Occupation. And I'm going to read the very first sentence of this book.
Okay.
Here it is. Right. In fact, it's not even the first chapter. It's the first sentence of the preface of the book. The very first thing in the book.
Yeah.
Occupation is a state of exception for international law. Seems to say nothing, right? Occupation is a state of exception for international law.
Exception with an E or exception with A-C-C? Exception
with an E.
Exception, yeah, okay.
Occupation is a state of exception for international law. Right, I want to just talk about that for just a moment or two.
Yeah, not too long, because we are already above 1 hour, and then we'll
right.
close up. And looking forward to the next time we come together.
Well, I hope so. Occupation is a state of exception for international law. Occupation, a state of occupation. A state of occupation?
Mm-hmm.
Imagine that, a state of occupation.
Yeah, that's a condition in what you are.
Yeah, it's a state, occupation is a state of exception for international law. In other words, nobody's interested in anything except the kindergarten, if you look at it like that. They want more of the same. They want more and better government.
Mm-hmm.
And when they choose that, when they're not interested in equity, they're not interested in a better solution to the practical things, they only look for a state solution. So eventually, the occupation is a state. It is a state of exception. Exception, what does that mean? It means they choose not to have a will. That's what it means. Their will is, the only will that they express is for the government. That's the only will that they will express. Therefore, every other kind of will is called an intestate will. You know what the word intestate means? It means that the man died without having a will. That's what intestate means. There's a testamentary will, and all other wills are simply legal pieces of paper, transferring the debts to the next generation.
He died intestate means
not having
a will before one dies. Yeah.
That's correct. Yeah. Yeah. So people pay lots of money to have a will made by a solicitor in the high street, or lawyer or something. And it's a legal will. It's not a testamentary will.
So how can we then make a testamentary will?
You're only transferring the same headaches to the next generation. Pay. Which man who is in normal, has some kind of sanity, who would transfer that to the next generation? Which man with a normal brain would do that? You would want to transfer it to the next generation so that they don't have these problems. And this is the estate that I'm talking about. So, anyway, thank you very much for the time.
You're welcome. Thank you very much for being a guest on my show, and I hope the listeners enjoyed this a little bit.
I hope so. I hope they will forgive our heresies as well if we said something that was wrong, but I hope not.
Well, I don't think that we really spoke unbiblically here together. So, and we always have the King James to check on that, even though I know that you sometimes like to use other Bibles, but when you did that, that was interesting because of the wording they used there, and that made a point.
Yes.
When they used the New Living Translation, but for the rest, we used the King James, and that's the only true preserved Word of God in my eyes, and in my opinion today. And I think you share that opinion for the most part.
I do, yes. I without being dogmatic about it, I will absolutely agree.
No, neither am I. I told people the reasons why I think the King James is the best, and it's on everybody on his own to find that out for himself, you know.
Absolutely, yes.
It's not my job to do that, but the King James at least is a Bible, and we were going through a little bit of an example here when we read this part in Luke 10 and then looking up Revelation 6. Yeah. We saw how, and that was a wonderful example, of we saw how the Bible explains itself.
And that Isn't is that right?
And that is something that you do not find easily with the corrupted versions of the Bible.
Absolutely true.
And therefore, I adhere to the King James. And I'm absolutely even glad that you brought that up, because by that comparison, that explanation between Luke 10 and Revelation 6, the story about the Good Samaritan, that was a very fine example to look at the Bible and see how the Bible actually explains itself.
Isn't that true? Isn't that true? And another thing I learned was that God makes everything happen, and it's not, sometimes it's not for us to interpret things, it's just to see, oh, look how it's happening.
Us to interpret it.
Yes.
When we exalt ourselves to the position that we are explaining or interpreting the Word of God, then we take the position that the Pope takes, that the Roman Catholic Church takes, which says that only her and her priests have the right to interpret and explain the Bible to the lay people.
Yes, that's perfectly true. I wholly agree with you about that. Thank you very much. That's tremendous. Okay.
Well, thank you very much, Robert. I enjoyed it very much. I hope my listeners too, and I hope to see you next time, and then we can continue on the equity law, on maybe go a little bit more into the straw man, whatever you want to prepare and show to my listeners in that regard. By the way, before we sign off, is there any possibility how my viewers can reach you? Is there a website? Is there an email that they can get to you to, or something? How you can be reached?
Yeah, if people wanted to contact me, that's I'll just put it here. That's okay.
You can say it because I'm still recording. So
I'll write it
later, and I will put it in the description box of the video.
That's fine. Yeah. Something that's an email address now. Maybe people want to have some evidence to support something or whatever. If I can help.
Whenever they have some questions, you know, I leave the commentary part in the video on YouTube open that people can comment on the video.
Very good.
But when they have some questions, and especially questions that go a little bit deeper into the subject that they could address to you, when I leave this robnewman111@yahoo.co.uk email address here, then they know how to contact you, and they can address their questions directly to you if you don't.
Fine, that's absolutely okay, and I will try my best to do that if I can. If I can find the answer, I will share it, of course.
Okay.
Thank you, Jörg.
Fine.
God bless. Thank you.
God bless you too. Bye bye.